drop another new joint on them right now.
The Bridge to Bridge Podcast with Big Mike and Baywatch starts now.
You know, y'all making the rain, changing the weather, you know, and through any endeavor. I love that, man. What's up with it?
For sure, man. Hey, speaking of family, Gomes, any relation to Dom Gomes? Okay.
Yeah, no. You similar the last name. I got that. So it's Portuguese last name. My grandpa, he from the East Coast. They like Cape Verdean, Portuguese, you feel me? I always say I'm black, but you feel me? The last name, that's it right there. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's real East Coast though.
We grew up with a Dom Gomes. Actually went to Sacred Heart.
He went to Sacred Heart? That's crazy. I didn't know that.
Yeah, same spelling. So, you know, you always got to check because that would be crazy. Yeah.
That's probably my cousin, bro. I'm going to keep it real.
He's Maltese, though. He always goes to Malta. That'd be funny if you did one of those tests and found out that you were Maltese and there was some relation.
That would be crazy. I'd be like, well, y'all, I'm going to pull up.
I like that sweatshirt. I like that sweatshirt right there.
Hey, thank you, bro. Hey, we got to go to the Maltese and drink some malt liquor. Come on, man.
They would know what's up.
I don't even drink like that, but hey, man, shout out to the sweatshirts. I had to put some in the background so y'all can see. I mean, you know, we still winning. Come on, can y'all see it?
That's a single. Yep, that's a single. And then the NFT you got back there, you did that with Kareem Mayfield, who was also on the show.
Yeah. And 10 Milli, you feel me? You know 10 Milli?
I don't know. I don't think I know him.
Kareem Mayfield is one of the Bay Apes. You feel me? So he's a part of the whole conglomerate. But 10 Milli, Jamal Truelove, he was in Last Black Man. He did a movie with Bruce Willis. He's from San Francisco, Sunnydale. He made the whole NFT project. So he's like he created everything.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Game on in the background real quick, man. I just had to put it on mute. I see y'all rocking y'all Warriors stuff.
We don't mess up.
Come on, man. All day, the Bay all day, baby. Hold on. Hey. You know, we got to put this in the interview. Can y'all see the TV?
Yep.
Come on, man. You know, you got to have it on. Oh, they down by four, bro. They was just up. Bro, the Warriors been tripping, bro. They 3-4 right now. That's crazy to see.
People are sweating it. It's not that big of a deal. It's early. I'm not too worried about it.
It's the weight of those rings on the hand on the offseason. It just messes up the shooting hand. Sometimes it messes the balance
up. That's how you brag right there. That's how you brag. Yeah. Now, they was talking about this because you peep the Rams is going through a similar thing right now where they're not bad, but it's like, yo, your performance should be way better. And they was talking about like when you win in certain ways, you get a high accolade. You know, people deem you the best. You feel me? You kind of get some type of laxness coming into your next year. You're not as hungry as you was. Feel me? You also might be injured. You might be tired because you had to push yourself. I feel like last year, what I wanted to do in my life, because I was getting so much love and elevation in my career, was not get lax. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't want to get that point where like, oh, yeah, I got one song that people like, you know, that, you know, it's gaining traction, but you know, that's cool. So, man, y'all didn't ask this question. I'm just being transparent.
No, dude.
We on a dope ass podcast. But so to combat that, what I did was I went and over record. Like, you see, I got a damn near mic in my room now.
Like, we got the mics just like this, dude.
Gotta play like you're down. Play like you're down.
Literally, bro. So I think I worked. And one thing Quake Beats said to me when we was making the project, we had been recording, like we created the vocal chain for that project over 3 years. The vocal chain, the BPM pattern, like even the sound, like it was over time, developed over time. But he was like, man, he was like, in 2018, you you came to my studio more than anybody else. Like he was like, you did that. He's like, over the last 2 years, you ain't did that as much. So I was like, all right. Once I made that project, I was like, you know, I got to really get in there. It's like going to the gym. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, man, I just had to say that because I know we're going to jump into
get
who
in
I am,
those,
man.
Get in those sets and reps. Get in those sets and reps.
Yeah. Yeah. You got to, man.
I love that, dude. You bring us right into it. So, I mean, can you talk a little bit about the early career and kind of how you got your rap career started? Like, well, what motivated you to start rapping? And you grew up in the city and stuff, so maybe talk a little bit about that.
Oh, man, I'm going to keep it real with you. This might sound super spiritual and metaphysical and all that other stuff, but it was really written for me before I was even here. And I say that because the influences come from before my time. Like, one of the biggest things is, like, you know, I rap for my uncle. My uncle was deaf. He passed away. He overdosed on cocaine. Feel me? That's why I'd be like, hey, test that cocaine, make sure it's not fentanyl in it before you use it, for sure. Not, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, it's like, I think we need to get into less of prevention and like trying to stop people to do it, to acceptance and letting people know, like, hey, yo, this is the outcome that can come out of it. Because America is free right now. The world is free. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you got to pick what you want to do. But getting back on topic, you know, my uncle, he was deaf, but his occupation he wanted to be so bad was a rapper. So I'm like, damn, that's hella crazy. So much so that he learned how to do sign language on beat. So it's like, you know, music, you got to hear the music to do it. You know what I'm saying? So for me, it was very perplexing. And I didn't understand how this person who can't, literally cannot hear, does have not have the physical capacity to hear. I hate saying that word, but he can't hear. He can basically rap in his version of what language is on beat. So that was crazy to me. And I was like, wow, he felt the vibrations of what music is. So, you know, long story long, going further deeper into it, you know, I was gifted with, from a young age, the ability to, even though I'm an introvert, to speak and articulate and just be like, yo, feel me, this is who I am. Like, since I was in preschool, I was always putting the plays, the acting or the speeches, like, oh yeah, we're just gonna have Jordan do the speech for the ceremony. Oh, you should do a speech here. You know what I'm saying? So I was always put into it. I think my mom had a lot to do with that, because she would read to me while I was in her belly, and she would read to me every night. And she would talk to me like an adult. Like, she would talk to me like, hey, yo, how you doing? Like, she wouldn't, like, baby talk me.
Right.
So, I know I'm talking hella long, but.
No, dude. This is, like, nah, dude, I love this. I want to hear this, bro.
We want it all, bro. This. We're here for having you talk long. That's how. That's what we're here for. Cool.
I'm going to go into the story, because I feel like, you know, you can really influence the next generation, especially kids that you have, by doing the proper habits to help them be successful. So my mom was big on that. She was big on reading. And I learned to talk and write at a young age. And then, like, you know, like, or normal age, like 5, but learning how to talk early. And then just having an interest in just rhyming, period. So, like, I just enjoyed the concept of rhyming. It sounded good. Like, I got a poetry book back when I first learned how to write, I think first or second grade. I have a poetry book from them. I'm going to keep it real. It was terrible. But you feel me? It's the early makings of, like, oh, this is what poetry is, and constantly elevating and always writing poetry. Then just hopping in, being with my homies, you feel me, from the hood, that kicking with, record a song on your phone. Then somebody takes it serious. Shout out to Mac Just. He actually bought all the equipment you needed to in order to record. So he's making songs with Roach Gigs. He making songs with rapping for, or a Lil Forte, rapping Forte's daughter. You feel me? He's working with all these people that are solidified at the age of 14. I think I was 13. And then just being at the right place, the right time, making a song. That sounded terrible to me, but everybody else loved it. And they was like, oh yeah, bro. Then I was just battling people for fun. Or, you know, being at Shake Your Heart, they'll drop a beat on the table. And I'm like, come on, you know, I got to go in at parties. And then taking it serious as I went through my life, going to Loyola, where G-Eazy graduated from, not knowing it was a music school, but just interacting with the people casually and just rapping with people who did it professionally. That was, this shit was dope. You know, it got me here.
When you started rapping and you kind of realized that you had the skills to do it, were you out on market, like getting people to listen to your stuff? Were you on
I had a kind of like a cheat code, because I was coming up in this group that was already kind of popular. And everybody already had their own individual popularity in terms of, like, okay, I'm that guy, but we are part of this group. And I learned a lot from them. And as we grew older, we started, like, when we was 12, as we grew older, like, all the way up until 18, we would become in conjunction with people who was, like, hella cool as well, or had that popularity or had that swag. Our biggest determinant was, feel me, you got to be from, like, an impoverished area. You got to have some type of, you feel me, front of hood. Second was, you got to have some game with the ladies. Like, you can't come around us and be dry. Even if you're quiet, you got to be able to speak. And just social skills in general. And then you had to have a positive mindset on, yo, I might be from the hood, but I don't want to be with the shit. I want to play sports. That was our biggest thing. Everybody in our group plays sport. So you got to think, you have a whole group of young men coming up who they go to different schools, but they all come together, and then we was throwing parties too. So before you know it, like from 12 to 15, we had a party every weekend. We playing sports. We go from like the younger people in the city to, yo, who is this dude that's in the newspaper for sports? Or, oh, we were respectively the top athletes at our high school while also throwing parties every weekend. So people just see you like, oh, these people making it happen.
What was the group?
Go ahead.
What was the group called that you were a part of?
It's called Bajip. It's a name that we created. It's B-A-W-J-P. It was an acronym for everybody's name at the time. It was Brandon, Austin, Wayne, myself, Jordan, and Papa. You feel me? Yeah. Brandon went to Wash. Austin went to Burton. Wayne went to Galileo. I went to Sacred Heart. And then my partner Papa went to Stuart Hall. So you can see, like, if you know the geography of the city, you got somebody in the avenues.
Y'all had the city surrounded.
Come on, man. We had our ideology in every part of the city. Like, it's that Bajib wave, how we was moving. Like, we wasn't thugs, but we was athletes, but we was in the scene, having fun, doing what we wanted to. So if you know the geography of the city, you know Brandon, he went to Wash, that's in the Avenues. Austin went to Burton, that's in the Bayview. Wayne went to Gal, that's kind of like, we say Marina. You can even get to North Beach, you know what I'm saying? Right. Like, around that area, it's a good place, market. Mm-hmm. Then I went to Heart of the City, you feel me? That's why I got the Heart of the City with me, you know what I'm saying? And then Papa, he went right up the street from me, but still in that Pack Heights area. Because if you know the city, Sacred Heart and Stuart Hall sit in two different areas, like, right, but that are so close.
That was like, he went to, that's like the Cranbrook. Y'all, you know, he got hit with that one, exactly, Cranbrook line off the 8 Mile, a little bit of Cranbrook.
Man, everybody for the 415, throw your hands up, man. We're going to keep it alive. We got to redo that movie. Y'all ready to act in it?
Yeah, I'll be like the old uncle.
Yeah. We're going to do it.
Mike can definitely be Cheddar Bob.
Oh, he on your line.
He has that locked.
So Dom, when he was at Sacred Heart, actually rapped and was featured on Wild 94.9.
Oh, congratulations, bro.
Yeah, this was back in the day, but very skillful with music and comedy and acting. He lives in LA, does stand-up comedy, so pretty similar upbringing.
Hey, come on, we gotta lock in, put something together, man.
The courtyard was the spot, and that's actually, like, you know, again, in between classes, you know, getting in those freestyles and just like out there in the courtyard and getting the crowd going, like, that's you know, you got a built-in audience like every day, pretty much.
Come on, man. And that's why social media is dope now. But, you know, being a part of your environment is important, to have a space to be able to do that freely. You know what I mean? And now the kids, they could take it and put it right there. Like, think if you had that ability when we was younger. Feel me? It was like, you don't really need a label. You know what I'm saying? Well, a label helps with the relationships and putting stuff behind you. It's like a direct to the people, like, I can show my talent on. That shit is crazy.
So what is that moment, you know, was it before high school or during or after, when you took it like, hey, this is now like, this is my, like, my career, my life's goal. Like, hey, this is not just rapping, but this is, I'm going to do this and whatever it takes to start putting in the sets and reps.
It was August 2016, feel me? I was working at Ghirardelli Chocolate Factory at the ballpark, selling hot chocolate. My catchphrase was hot chocolate, no, I'm not just talking about myself. So, you know, I was getting it off, having fun, confidence was high. Feel me? I wasn't in the best shape of my life, but I was working out constantly, you know, on my workout journey. But I was just in a place where I was going back to school. Like, I had a lot of things going for me, and I was confident. I was like, I felt like I was, my life was together enough where I was like, you know, I want to make a push for doing this thing that I use as a hobby, or, you know, that I enjoy doing. And I was like, I really want to do this every day. Like, it's fun. So I dropped a freestyle. It's called, it was to Monica So Gone. It was a So Gone challenge. I dropped it and I put it out there. And at the time, people was like, okay, this is dope. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I was like, okay, I'm going to keep going. So I started like every other Friday, maybe once a month, not as frequently as I wanted to, but I just started dropping covers to songs. But the first one I did, I turned that into a song, shot a music video, and it had gained so much traction that I had to get the song taken down from whatever label owns that beat. Cause it was like, oh yeah, you gotta take this down. They deleted my Twitter, hella stuff. But this was in 2016 when I was like, yo, I gotta do this every day. That was the first moment. The second moment was when I came home and I was like, all right, I got 3 hours to chill. I came home at like 6 or 7. I was like, I'm gonna go to bed 9 or 10. So in that 3 hours, I'm going to do my homework, I'm going to write some music, and I'm going to play some video games. So I picked up my Xbox, the Xbox controller first. So I started playing it.
That's something Mike would do.
Man, exactly. Me and Mike right here. Michael Jordan, we in conjunction.
Bro, shut up.
So I pick up that controller, and I play video games for 3 hours. And I was like, oh, I didn't do no homework, and I didn't write no music. The next day, I sold my Xbox, and then that was like 2017. So I feel like those are two big moments where I was like, okay, I need to break the habits that stop me from doing this every day if I said I'm going to do it every day. And then, like, I was doing it every day, but I wasn't putting that. Like, I was like, I had a job, and I had to do this and had to do that. I feel like the next step for me was the third thing that really took it to the next level. I had graduated college. This was 2019. I graduated college, did the feature film Last Black Man in San Francisco. I dropped the song Out That Window, and it started gaining traction. It's probably like my second biggest streaming song right now. And then, like, I was like, I had went out the country for the first time. Shout out to Last Black Man, Gunna, everybody involved with that, on help telling me to get out the country.
Oh, you got to travel.
Yeah, you got to travel. So it blew my mind, and I ended up quitting my job. Like, I remember a conversation I had with my boss before I left and asking for a raise. And he was like, basically,
The job still at the ballpark?
Nah, this was when I was at the ballpark, I was working at JBR Partners Inc. As well as selling the hot chocolate. And then I was hustling anything I could. So I was really running it up. I ended up buying the tips. My first car I ever bought was from the tips I made from the ballpark. So I had like three jobs for now, and I was pursuing rap. And I was going back to school. Like, I was on one. I don't know what type of life I was living. I was like, yeah, come on. And I just wanted it bad, like, feel me? So it's like, I bought a car off that. But yeah, I stayed with this job. They helped me. Shout out to JBR's Partners Inc. because they helped me have a flexible schedule throughout going to college, rapping and everything. So I get with them, and you know, my boss, he was hella cool. His name is James Bryant. Cool dude. He taught me so much. But I was at a point where I was becoming a man for real, and I wanted things, and I was ambitious, and I was aggressive, and I was like, man, I need more money to go maybe not necessarily do this job, but I didn't have necessarily a passion for that, but to go do my passion, because I was doing it every day to the point that I needed more time to do it. So he told me something important. He was like, I wasn't worth the amount that I was asking for in a raise. And then when I went out the country, I found out that he was right and wrong. He was right that I wasn't worth that, but I was actually worth more. And to see how they treated us out the country, it was crazy. I went to Switzerland, Locarno, Switzerland. Then I went to Paris, France. And so going out there, it got me out of my comfort zone, because we got out there, we land too late to take the train from Germany, I think Zurich, to Locarno. So we stranded. So I get off the plane. I'm like, man, fuck it. You know, you got to just try something. I yell hella loud in the train station. I'm like, does anybody here speak English? And everybody looking at me, they like, what the fuck? Black dude in Germany. Feel me? So he's like, what the hell? And then it's like one dude just, I was like, does anybody speak it? What's up? And then that one dude just stood up. I speak English. Hella cool. Man, he let us stay at his house. He gave us a ride. Like, he could have Jeffrey Dahmer'd us. Come on, man. Like, it could have got real. But God was looking out for us. You feel me? It could have got Manny. And, you know, but that's the experience I need to know. Like, okay, even in that whole experience, that whole trip was just, you know, learning lessons, like getting stranded, you know, not having enough money to do something, not having this, but still having to get it done. And I feel like going on that trip made me realize, like, okay, if I don't have this job that's supporting me any longer, I'm going to still figure out a way to make it. And that was big in, you know, keeping me going right now and not getting complacent. When I, you know, for all means, I could be like, oh, yeah, I did enough. You know what I'm saying? But it's not enough. It never will be. No.
I got a question. You know, you were mentioning you're an introvert and you were working a lot. Do you have a process? You know, obviously, the more, like, administrative stuff you're doing, it kind of kills creativity.
And, yeah, for sure.
Do you have a process to put yourself in the creative zone, or do you just throw yourself like, hey, I'm going to the studio for 2 hours, whether I want to create or not, and I'm making myself do it? Or is it like at certain times,
you get
motivated? Yeah. You know, what do you do to get into that space?
I'm fortunate. So I'm going to tell this part and then I'm going to say what I do. It's a producer DJ just Bay Area socialite and legend named Drew Banga. Me and him got a project called It's Big out right now, and it's going up. Drew told me, he was like, you have a talent, it's called you're entertaining on cue. So it's like, I didn't understand that for a minute, because that question you asked me was like, okay, how do you prepare to get ready? And I definitely got my preparation methods, but I also got something to where I can be sleep, like REM sleep, knocked out, and somebody tell me, hey, wake up, we gotta go, you gotta go perform, or wake up, you gotta do this scene or whatever. I can literally turn it on like that and be in it. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I have my days where I gotta warm up, and I've done everything to do so. I've had like mental health days where I'm like, all right, I'm not talking to anybody so I could be like this. I had my period of time where I was like, all right, I'm finna just smoke, feel me, right before I do this. And anytime I get tired, to lock back in. And I don't think smoking necessarily makes you more creative. I think Jay from Jay and Silent Bob said that it just clears the cobwebs sometimes. You know what I mean? So doing that, I done did, what else is there? You know, do the things where it's like, hey, I had a period where I would tell young ladies I was dating, especially my girl now, I'd be like, hey, before we go to the studio, you know, I'm not talking about this right now. You know, I need to be focused. I had times where I'd use a Michael Jackson method where if I'm not answering the phone, if I'm in the studio, because you might throw me off. But, you know, I feel like I'm fortunate because I could always just tap in. Unless I'm exhausted, like some, even then, it's just been times where I just got to tap in. So I think that's part of it. And then just finding new ways because, you know, everybody wants everything to be perfect. But some of the best things that ever been made have been made through imperfection. So, you know, they've been made through a trialing time or when you weren't at your best. Some of the best games, you don't have a Michael Jordan flu game if he's 100% health. You know what I mean?
Maybe they
so
lose.
It's like, you know what I mean? So it's like, I recall times where me and my girl just argued and I went in the studio and in 6 hours, I made like six songs. All slap, like, feel me, going on one. It had been times where like, you know, I maybe felt depressed or something like that. And I stepped out of my comfort zone to release my emotions and, you know, put it out there. Or I've been nervous and did it. So it's like, for me, it's like, whatever way I could get it done, I'm going to get it done. If that's like, I got to be on it right there. If that's, I get the time to take a bath and relax, cool. So, you know, I think it's just in me, you know. But I'm always looking for different ways, though.
I've heard some artists talk about like microdosing mushrooms. You ever try that?
Hell yeah. What? Come on, man. I've tried every drug that's not like, okay, this shit could kill you. All the natural shit I fucked with. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I even used to like, if you hear it in my music, if I said I did it in my music, that mean I really did it. I might not have been doing it at that moment. I might not have abused it, but I've tried it. Like, okay, you know what's up? I feel like, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, you ever get like too high and you kind of psych yourself out by just recording or
make something where you're like, yo, that's the hottest thing I ever spit. Then you listen the next day, you're like, bro, this is a no-go.
This is the thing about me. Like, if I get on there, I'm at that point in my career where I had to develop like everything I do, I'm in love with. You know what I'm saying? So like, I'm at that point that's where sick. I found my groove, even though I'm stepping out of my comfort zone. You know what I mean? I feel like I'm at the point where everybody might not love it, but I'm like, okay, this shit slap. You know what I mean? So I think, and then I also, when I get to that point where I'm like, okay, I never go too far, like with the stuff. Like I never be like, I'm not going to be in a studio sloppy drunk. I might've had one or two shots to get me loose. Like it was this time I was in the studio. I had just came from doing a show in Modesto. So I'm high off of doing a show. Then they said I was waiting in the studio to see if Jack Harlow was going to pull up. You feel me? So I was like, oh man. But I had to go do my show. I came back. It was actually G-Eazy, Guap Dad, All Black, all in the studio. And I come in and they like, they got the whole song finished. They like, man, we can't find a hook. Then they all look at me. It felt like a movie moment. They all looked at me and they was like, hey, Stunner, bro, you got to come with a hook. And I said, I grabbed the bottle, took a shot, and I was like, come on, play that. Or I kept rapping it, did it in one take. But, you know, that's off the, when the energy prevails it, then I'm going to do it. I'm not going to front. I'm not going to be the dude where it's like, we got five strippers on deck, and I'm chilling with whatever the hottest star is. And then right. They like, hey, here goes this coke. Want to snort off her butt? I'm like, hey, yo, I might have to pass, man. Right, this might be a family show, but I'm not going to judge anybody who does do that because that's somebody's creative process, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it's a lot of, go ahead.
No, so when you started getting you know, popular and started coming out with songs, I'm sure you started interacting with some of the Bay's other rappers out there. Would you say that there was like, so, you know, there's been, I've heard people say that sometimes like being an artist in the Bay Area is like the toughest of all the cities because there just isn't as much support. Do you feel like other Bay Area rappers were like welcoming to you and like they wanted to bring you along, or did you really feel like you were kind of on your own?
I feel like it's a great phrase. It says, you're not lifted up by the people that are above or ahead of you, but you supported up by the people below you. Feel me? You supported. That's why it's supporters. So when it comes to Bay Area rap, I think it's more like you got to prove yourself before I get behind what you're doing. Because it's like at the end of the day, that's what it is in the Bay. Like a lot of times I feel like you go to other places and just by off your look or anything, you can go a long way. Now, the Bay, we respect and we like shiny things, pretty things, but really it's about your character. And that's what people get behind. You know what I mean? So I feel like I was saying I was doing it and people would see me in the scene, but it was like, okay, when are you going to do something that lets me know, like, okay, you really taking this shit serious? Or are you connected with the people in a way? Or you got something that makes the people just feel what you're doing? And I feel like I even carry a bit of that. And that's kind of how I help myself decipher, okay, who just doing this for clout, or even if it's or not clout, or who just doing this because I just trying to get the benefits from rap, or who's not doing it for a genuine reason versus somebody like, yo, I really want to do this. Like, you know what I mean? I really want to be a part of this because I want to impact the culture. And it's like, yeah, for me, that's really what it was. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, no, okay, I just think it's interesting. There's a lot of like, you know, we love the Andre Nicotina, San Quinn, Big Rich, Philly. I mean, like all those mm-hmm. groups and all those artists are people that we just love and adore. So I was just curious, Dom, you want to add something to that?
Yeah, I was curious, Jordan, like who were some of your go-tos growing up in the Bay Area music mm-hmm. influence wise?
I'm going to go back to his question real quick before I answer that.
For sure.
I think there's support, but there's no infrastructure. Like, well, there's a budding infrastructure, and we have the independent infrastructure on point. So we can stand by ourselves, but we need to build. That's the biggest thing for me, what I see. And it's like, we definitely got the support because people slapping hands and helping each other and making music all the time. We just need to find these
big business infrastructure.
Exactly. Like, really, like, treat this like an organization. You know what I mean? Like, and because that's what it is. Like, rapping, it's like, It's showbiz, and it's two parts of that word. You got to have a nice show that's creating the content, the music, and everything, but you also got to understand the business of it, and that's how you get everything to the next level, doing both, not one or just focusing on one too much. And it influences, man, any rapper that was, like, on TV, that was acting, while that was rapping, I was a fan because I was always a fan of that variety, that versatility, that duality, where you could be really on there. You do a whole other genre as your true profession, but you're able to step into this lane that oftentimes is hella different. Like, you see a lot of artists now, rappers, you know, they're very introverted. So it's like some rappers might not even do interviews. Lil Baby
Kendrick
like,
Lamar, yeah, plenty.
Yeah, like they don't even do interviews. So to see like people like it's the list is go like, it's endless, you know, because that's how many rappers it are. But like even see a Ice-T, Young, DMX, you know what I'm saying? Even Will Smith, people kind of cut him out, but to see him make that transition to be the first rapper to win a Grammy, then go be one of the best actors, like that shit is dope. And even see him drop stuff later in life. So, you know, those are my biggest influences. In the Bay Area, particularly, I was fortunate enough to be from the same neighborhood JT the Bigger Figure was from. So, Figure Panamera now. And I talked to him like last week, you know, just hearing his words, you know, his prophetic type vision, because he saw a lot of things that people didn't. And working with a man who managed him, I was just fortunate to see real life examples of people that were doing it in real time. So that was hella dope. You know, everybody you named, you know, just, and I come from a rapping neighborhood, you know what I mean? So that was dope for me. But for me, I wanted to see more people like myself, where it was like, you from the hood, but you don't live, like, I'm not a thug, I'm not a gangster, like, I might talk about experiences I did in my life, but, you know, I'm not really selling that lifestyle, you know, mm-hmm. and that's why somebody like Larry June is dope, you know,
yeah,
for me, he's got the healthy lifestyle, you know what I mean,
right.
And even my next project, I don't think I directly took it from him, but I'm pretty sure he inspired me and influenced me because I was already about the healthy lifestyle, but to continue to be myself. Like, my next project is healthy gas. You feel me? He talked about the healthy organic lifestyle all the time. I mean, so it's definitely seeing stuff like that. It's how my peers, I'm like, oh, yo, this is dope. I'm on that wave too. So I got to pay homage to him for sure. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, that's pretty much it. Anybody could think.
No.
Like, yeah, I mean, Bay. Unless they trash, then I'm like, man, you mentioned, know, but music's subjective.
Yeah, you mentioned JT, and it's crazy because Bay Area rappers were making music before anyone even, like, at the birth of rap and hip-hop.
Yeah.
I remember, like, one of JT's, like, some of the oldest, like mixtapes way back, and it's made off the most simple beats, and they're just like, hey, we're just doing it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so,
it,
sure.
Like, the history is insane. And
yeah, like, Too Short and Freddie B, the first Oakland rapper, you know what I'm saying, deemed himself 1979, like, that's when hip-hop. When, what's the date of hip hop? Like 1978 or something like that?
Right around there where you had, like, you know, Run DMC was coming out, like early 80s, and like they were right there making tracks, you know?
Nah, so it's sure. Like, so it's like, you feel me though? It's like, it's definitely like a long history of dope ass Bay Area rappers.
Was there ever a moment when you got in the studio with someone from the Bay Area and you were like, damn, like, I'm in the studio and we're making a track? Like, not like, you know what I mean? Like, that a moment where you're like, whoa, like.
Nah, every time it'd be like, it'd be a mix of, like, not getting intoxicated by it. Kobe Bryant talked about this, but not being intoxicated, but also for me to have the, like, the presentness to be like, yo, this moment is really happening. And it was like that experience I just told. It's like, being in a studio with All Black, like, that was one of my favorite rappers ever. So to be in a studio with him and just to listen to him, hear him talk about life, for him to know who I am, that was big. You know, being in a studio with D-Lo, you know what I mean, Neff, you know what I mean, all these people where it's like, these are my peers, but y'all going crazy, you know? So it's like, I feel like it's a lot of people I want to work with too. Sometimes it's even, what helps me too is like seeing the up-and-coming artists, like working with them and seeing like the hunger that they have for it. And being like, damn, you hella dope. Like, you hella raw. Like, I went to perform at Mission High School last week. And it's this artist named Max Sale. I think he's from Oakland. I don't know where exactly. But, like, he came out with dancers, these twins that go crazy from the Bay Area. He was dancing with them, like, on beat and everything. Hit the splits. And I was like, yo, while he was rapping, like, he just took the whole genre. He just took the whole sport of rapping to the next level. Because when he blows up, he's going to be the standard. Like, it's like, damn, you know what I mean? So that was hella. Oh, while we talking about it, I want to say RIP, or win in peace to Take Off from the Migos. He got passed away today. That's unfortunate. You know, we got to keep talking about how, you know, rapping is one of the most dangerous sports out there. And it's like, when it comes to it, you know, just being in the wrong place at the wrong time, you feel me, is big, you know, because he was a bystander in what was going on. But, you know, very unfortunate. You know what I'm saying? Very unfortunate.
That literally leads me into the next topic, man. I mean, obviously, in the last year, your notoriety has gone up crazy.
Keep talking. I'm going to get my charger while you
know. No, you're chilling. I just, you know, how do you stay out of trouble? How do you make sure to not be in the wrong place at the wrong time?
Man, this might sound crazy, but, you know, at Sacred Heart, when we play football, you know, we had to wake up at 5 a.m., you know, to go work out, 6 a.m. for 6 a.m. workouts. Shout out Coach Lee. You know, and doing that, I still used to party and everything, and I could get away with it for a minute, but it got to a point where as an adult, I wanted to be, I told myself at the beginning of this year, I want to look and feel like a professional athlete, like be in the best shape I ever been in my life. So I ramped up my workout schedule. Like, I'm talking about running 5 miles a day, lifting while playing a sport, like best shape I ever been in my life. So in order to do that, your body needs a lot of recovery. It needs a lot of rest. And over the last year, for me, if I'm not performing, like if I don't have to go or I'm not getting paid or it's not like I'm really like committed to this, and not to say I don't want to be at places, if it's just for fun, man, I got to relax and stay home, or I got to do something more intimate that doesn't require me to use hella energy, because the energy I got, I have to preserve. So in a way, keeping a strict ass schedule and staying ambitious on what I want, it balances me out of going out to places to possibly be at the wrong place at the wrong time. Like, you know, like my whole team, it was hella funny. I encourage and I I kind of push it on my team. Not even kind of. It's a foundational like requirement that if you're a part of still winning, you have to work out. You have to have some type of workout plan. So this past weekend, everybody on my team, I was like, what y'all do? He's like, man, we just stayed in. We was hella tired because we've been working out and going to work and doing this, where it kind of keeps you disciplined. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to go drink if you know the next day you got to go to the gym. You know what I mean? And you fighting for a goal. So, you know, and then just being around the right people. You know, I kind of like, this might sound many, but my day one partners that are on the same mindset that I'm on, I'm rocking with you wherever. But if you don't have concentrated like goals to get to where I'm trying to get, I don't want to be disrespectful. And if we have interactions that when I see you, that's cool. But I literally cannot spend time, you know, like catting off or doing anything that's not helping my development and where I want to go. You know,
yeah, it changes your wavelengths. It kind of you know what I mean, gets you off the wavelengths, and then you got to recover from that.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean I don't want to be around people that I love. It just means like if it come down to it, it's like, yo, I'm not doing this. Are you gonna come to the gym with me in the morning? If we stay up this late, or we do this, or we do that. If not, bro, I'm not going. I'm not finna be there. So you know, but I always find time to kick it with people who might not share the same lifestyle I do. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I see you at the football game, and you're active in the community, man. Which,
come on, man.
I work.
I could do a lot more though. I could do a lot more.
Hey, we're gonna do.
Come on, let's do it. Yeah. We all can. Sure.
On the staying out of trouble, I work with there was a firefighter I used to work with, OG firefighter, and he had this phrase: nothing good happens after midnight. You know, because he's always going on the 911 calls, and he's like, "Yo, my worst calls are always after midnight. Like the worst of the worst. You know, worst accidents, worst." You know, stuff like that. So he was always saying nothing good happens after midnight, buddy.
That's a fact.
Yeah, sure.
So my bad.
Now you get it's messed up though, because nothing good happens after midnight. But if you want to have fun, those opportunities, and that's just in life though, you know, bigger the risk, bigger the reward, you know. But you know, so it's like, you know, when you're young, you know, it's you keeping it lit at night, like, oh yeah, this opportunity with this young lady can happen, or you know, that's what you're searching, you're seeking for, or this opportunity to make money or have fun, you know, whatever it really is, you know. So I just say, you know, like five times.
No, yeah. You're good. Hey.
We're gonna have a you know counter on the end of this podcast.
Hey, that's right. Mike says dive in usually at least five times before the start of the podcast.
I'm weak.
He goes, hey, phrase. Hey man, before we dive into this, we'll shut run the up, tape dude. Back into
shut
the counter.
The hell up. Yeah, listen, hold on. So,
hey, Mike, like he might like swimming and stuff.
Yo, he got that Michael Phelps vibe. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Just see, like, Mike, I get it. He tall. You feel me? Lanky with it. He got some. Like, I see the muscles. He's trying to wear the tight shirt. I see,
hey,
man.
Dog. You feel
oh,
me?
Okay, flex on him then.
Hey, Dom, hey, you know, Jordan knows our Danny really well, dude. And yeah, he's told me some funny stories.
Bro, his transformation from high school to like early 20s and now, bro, it's that crazy. Shit was crazy. But see, you know what he did? He got serious. He got serious about that shit. He was like, everybody was telling him because he was always hella strong and hella athletic. Always. But everybody was like, the coaches literally be like, come on, man. You hit them weights. When he really hit them weights, he took that shit serious, bro. I was like, yo, that shit was crazy.
Got up to over squatting 800 pounds. Just like, that was some of my best times, though, because we would go out and I go like, yo, like if anyone gets out of line, I'm like, Dan, will you handle my associate?
Handle my lightweight, you know what I'm saying? You know what I mean?
I'd be like, hey, you get past Dan who squats 805, like then come talk to me. But you talk to Dan first, I'll be over here.
That lets you was on your Thanos vibes. Like, all right, if you could get through this, maybe I'll spend some time with you.
Yeah.
You know, I feel that, you know, that preserves energy. But nah, Dan, he dope, man. Even his mindset now, you know, he progressed to.
He's about his business.
Yeah, he very focused. I haven't talked to him in person in a while, but I can tell he still has that jolliness and that kind of like, not boisterous because he a man now. But like that, still like that smile or that character.
Yeah, he's a sweet kid, dude. He's a sweet kid for sure.
Nah, for sure. You need that though.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
You gotta have it.
Yeah, so but I remember him farting, eating hella sandwiches. He was like, yeah, him and CJ Pardini. You know what I'm saying? He was dope though. I like to match their energy.
Big Dan.
Yeah. We had a dope ass like their class, and I was a class under them. We was hella dope. One thing I did notice about us. other than maybe like a couple people like Kyle Church, Tino Miles, Zach was pretty focused too. Like, you know, we was about it, but we was like still like enjoying the elements of San Francisco. Like San Francisco is a comfortable ass city. Mm-hmm. So much so to where you got that grit about you, but it's like our city is really cool as fuck. You don't know how fucked up shit is till you leave. And you don't know what San Francisco is missing to you. But it's like, we was at that point where it's like, man, you know, football is cool, but like, shit, I'm trying to go to the movies or I got all these other things I like to get into. Like, life is really good when you're from the city, even if you're from like a bad part of it. So I think we wasn't as focused because, you know, half the team was like, oh, yeah, next day we're going to drink at the Grove to socialize. You feel me? Another half of the team, I know we was trying to party. You feel
hey,
me?
That's one thing. San Francisco, the youth that go out drinking at some of the nicest landmarks in the world. You know what I mean? Man, like you're going to like the Grove, Palace of Fine Arts, Ocean Beach. You're like, it's like crazy.
Even Lombard sometimes, Twin Peaks, you feel me? I don't suggest the Golden Gate Bridge, but you know, people might do that one night. Or, you know, one of my exes, when I was early 20s and I was of legal age, one thing we used to do, she was like, let's go to a random neighborhood and take a drunk walk in San Francisco. And, you know, you got to navigate it because you don't want to hit one of them hills while you're drunk, you know.
Yeah.
But
one place folks didn't go was Stowe Lake, though, because it's super haunted. You know, no one messed with Stowe Lake.
I heard they grabbing people to this day. To this day, you know what I'm saying? They grabbing people up. You got to be careful in Stowe Lake. But that's Stowe Lake definitely is how you get the cool points with the young lady. Slide by there, like, you know.
Get on that boat. Get on that rowboat real quick. Just chilling in that.
See, hey, man. See, when you know, when the melanin is different, you know, you're going to take more risk. Me, I'm hey, brother. Look, I know how to swim, but not with ghosts and shit. You
know what I mean? Dude, so when the banger started coming out and you made your most famous track, I mean, how quickly did life change?
I feel like life. I'm not even gonna give one of them like hell.
It's always changing.
I feel like I always been. My mom told me this. She was like, if you play football, if you were one of the biggest actors ever, she's like, whatever you did, if it recorded fame or if it had some type of fame to it, you were always gonna be the most popular person there, even if you weren't the best. So like, she was saying, she did football. She was like, if you were a bench player and you were in the NFL, you would still be one of the most popular players on the team. You might not be the best. So she said, if you're going to be the most popular, you might as always be the best. Might as well always be the best. So when the stuff started to come, I had already kind of been living like how it was coming. There was some, like in terms of like, you know, they say when you get more like looks, or you start coming up, you know, women treat you different, you know. But I had already found my way to be like, in my head, like 6 years ago, I said I would never not be able to get a woman because she didn't know who I was or because I didn't have money. So I developed ways. You got to have mouthpiece. You know what I mean? Yeah. Even opportunities like that came. It's a lot easier now. Don't get me wrong. Like, I definitely got a lot of leverage. But I would say I would never get an opportunity because somebody didn't know who I was, or because I didn't have the resources to get it. Feel me? So, you know, a lot of things have changed, like, you know, but like I'm kind of spoiled because we threw events back in the day. So every time I go to the club, I would go to the club when I was younger, they'll let us in. I'm talking about when I was before 18, getting into older clubs. So,
and then right before the pandemic, in diapers in the club.
Yeah, literally, you feel me? Literally, I like that. He got that bait, feel me? But
that's going to be on the next track for sure. Been in the club since diapers.
Oh, been in the club since diapers.
That's it.
I got a cougar on me. Said she got some wipers.
Ooh. Yep.
Her husband like, oh no, swiper, no swipers. Now you know she called me like a plumber, so you know I had. You know what I'm saying?
That's it.
Yeah, that'll definitely be. I definitely got to use that.
So things move fast. Things were going kind of crazy quickly.
Yeah, nah, it was like a mix. It was like when getting there felt like forever. Like, it felt like, damn, like, you know, they don't want to – I've had a lot of great experiences, but it felt like, damn, when is going to be my time where I walk in here and they playing my music? Or when is going to be my time they hitting me for shows? Or when is going to be my time, but I stay patient? And whenever it wasn't my time, I always was like this. But not like, oh, man, this person shouldn't be up there. It was like a, hey, that's what's up. Keep going. Like, it was genuine. And if I didn't feel like that, I was like, man, I'm not going to fake it. But I made sure that I never felt like that about somebody else. That's why I think, like, right now, no matter where I got a long way to go, but I'm getting a lot of love, like a lot of love. Like, I feel like that's what I put out. Even when I didn't want to, or it might not have been in my best interest, or even when I didn't even have to, it wouldn't have been justified, I still gave it. You know what I mean? So I think that was big. So, you know, things, but yeah, it was like what they say, the bamboo tree. Like, it felt like hella long when you planting it. But then as soon as that shit sprout, that shit shoot up. And
what are some things looking ahead? Give us some view into like some upcoming shows, songs,
movies, albums, TV shows, Bay Area based right now. I've been writing, proud to drop a project November 18th, Healthy Gas, you feel me? That's a healthy tape, triple entendre. If people don't know, but STUNNAMAN02, that O2, that's the chemical symbol for oxygen gas. That's all I spit. So on this Healthy Gas, that's all you finna get. Another entendre. You know, the Bay Area, we got the best of it, you feel me? I'm coming out with a strand as well, but in the meantime...
Who's doing the strand for you?
Gotta be Kareem.
I need to work with Kareem, but it's this dude named Sean Richards. Okay. Sean Richardson, or either Sean Richards, one of the big homies from the neighborhood. He owns Burners on Hate. You feel me?
Oh, yeah, yeah, okay.
So you feel me? So we got this out right now. These are the pre-rolls, the healthy pre-rolls called Feel More. Definitely a double entendre on that. Maybe triple, but you know,
like
we
that.
Come with it.
That one hit me late.
You said you wanted to be late?
No, it hit me late. I said Feel More. I'm like, okay, I see what they you did there. Me? Now, feel more. Two second delay.
Come on, man. You know, y'all city guys. You know
that's inception right there, planting seeds right there.
What about doing a collab with Pilo? Pilo was on the show. We got to set you guys up and to do something with
you. Hey, I'm gonna tell you a secret that a lot of people don't know, and we starting to put it out there more. But this might like blow your head. Like it's about to like feel me. I don't know, but Pilo is actually STUNNAMAN02, and STUNNAMAN02 is actually Pilo. Like, think about that for a second. Like, think about that for a real second. Like,
explain it. We got to hear it from you.
That's all he has to say. That's all he has to say.
I don't want to say too much insight, you know, but if you go look at Pilo's last album, his last album was named Stunner. So, you know, that's just the hints that we're giving to the world right now, because we really, like, you know, we don't want to put too much stuff out there, because if we do, we're going to expose this whole secret society that's happening in the music industry. So, you know. We do stuff like that. Well, yeah, I got a song Pilo produced on my next album called Healthy Gas. It's called Get That Dough. We was in L.A. in his house, and I just punched in every lyric, and he was laughing the whole time. And it was like fun. It was all energy.
Super. That's
right. Well, dude, but before we let you go, dude, we do this thing. It's called
Before I let you go.
We do kind of like this. What do you call it, Don?
It's called a lightning round, and it's a very difficult trivia round where it's only for people from the Bay, because it's all Bay questions. And if you win,
South Carolina,
if you win, you get to keep this belt. It's only
y'all got prizes. Okay, come on.
Some of the legends that have won, GP2 had the belt for a while.
Okay, come on.
You know, we had Jeremy Fish had the belt for a hot day, but then Mike gave too many hints. The questions are very hard, but we're going to work with you and try to, you know, get through. The rounds are set up per industry. So it'd be like for our round right now, it'd be, you know, freestyle cassette tapes out of the back, first album, and then Grammy round. You know what I mean? And if you win the final round, it's like
you get the belt.
You know what I'm saying?
Bro, these sound like some complicated topics right here, man. Y'all about to expose my lack of Bay Area knowledge right here.
We're gonna work through it, and we're gonna give you some. Let's see how we roll. Okay,
y'all really biologists. All right, come on, man, let's do it.
Well, you don't mess around, dude.
First question is: name one Muni line that runs through the Fillmore. Any Muni buck. Five foot. That's it, bro.
Oh, so man, on the top of my head, we gotta get some bread.
You're big stepping out of the first round. Easy. Easy. Okay, I'm gonna give you I think. How familiar are you with Fully Loaded and Big Rich and all and some of their music?
Management for a period of time, but I got to keep it real. Like, way back in the day growing up, I wasn't hella tapped in. I'm going to keep it real. I used to listen to, like, Disney music, for real.
Yeah.
Like, I used to listen to, like, Michael Jackson. Like coming up. I didn't really
freestyle it up, Dom. It's okay.
No, yeah, we like, can. Okay, we're gonna move. We're going to save that for a harder round. I'm going to ask you this one. Okay, I saw on the Instagram you had a little piece on this. What street in San Francisco was the Full House home on? What street was it on in San Francisco? Damn, the house used.
I know the vicinity.
You can go vicinity, and then we'll give a street guess, and we may let you slide through one round, but we'll go ahead. Give me a vicinity.
Well, going by the geometric measurements in particular.
I mean, you can give me a latitude, longitude, and like that's also, you know.
I'm trying to put it together. The Fahrenheit-ish type weather that surprises the San Francisco area. I believe it's associated to a particular park called Alamo Square. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So I know that much, but the particular street I might not be familiar with.
Okay, I'm going to give you a hint.
All right.
The name of the street is also the last name of one of the stars who was on Friends. He was like the comedian guy on the show Friends. His last name is also the name of the street in San Francisco.
Okay. Does this street also, this name that this person has, is it also the name of a famous Celtic player?
I'm not sure. Nope. I mean, it could be.
Okay.
No. Nope, it starts with a B. It starts with a B. It starts with a B. And
with a B.
Rhymes with stick.
The last part of it was the guy played Chandler. Chandler on Friends. The actor played Chandler.
Damn. And this is real life, real name in real life?
This is a real street. This is his real name. We could. I mean, do we call?
Nah, man. Hold on. These questions is socially, economically set up, bro. I'm black. Y'all know I don't watch Friends.
Hey, you had the pic on Instagram of the Full House. You had the Full House. That's what we got.
Let me work through it. So B. Damn.
Okay, I'm gonna give you what's called a substitute.
Oh, I think I got it. Is it Broderick Street?
There
you
it
got
is,
it, bro.
Come
you
on, got, man. I had to work through it, man.
You got it,
Friends.
Okay, you got it.
And
it
hits help. The B gave it away.
Okay.
I like Friends, by the way. That's a good song.
Sure. This is a throwback track. I'm not sure to make this championship. Okay. Here we go.
Dom, ask the question that we was.
Here we go. Third question. Okay.
No way he's getting this, bro.
This is a tough one, but this is your second to last belt question. So there's a lot of Bay Area legends, right? You know.
Yeah.
There's a ton. I need the names of three Bay Area legends with the first name of William, Will, or Willie. It can be any three Bay legends with the first names of William, Willie, or Will.
Willie Mays.
Okay, that's one.
Okay, we got Willie Mays. Willie McCovey.
Oh, okay, that's two.
Willie McCovey, and I'm going to go the person who has the most NBA championships. 11, Bill Russell.
Okay, he went with the Bill Russell. Okay.
Well, you said Bill is one of the ones, right?
Yeah, does he have Bay Area roots, though? Because we may not, I got to check with the judges. Does Bill Russell have Bay Area?
He went to USF.
Okay. Did he? Okay.
Yeah, man, he's from the town. He's a Don.
We said Willie Mays, Willie Brown, who was the mayor, and ooh. Will Clark. But you got,
y'all said Bill was one of the options, though, right?
Yeah. Oh, no, you got it, dude. No. You even taught us some stuff right there.
Damn. Oh, man. You know, I'm a real Bay Destrian. I'm a real San Franciscan, a Phil Mullian.
Okay, well.
100.8. You know what I'm saying?
You're at Grammy round, final round. I'm going to play a song. Okay? This song is off of Fully Loaded's album called Reloaded.
Okay.
Big Rich, Bailey, Don Toriano, featuring the Ritla. It's a football-themed song. I need the name of the song, and I'm gonna play it for you first, and then we can dip into it.
He gonna get Shazam on right now. Cool. He got Shazam.
When you hear the announcer in it, you're gonna recognize the song.
Give me the rock. I control the clock, the tail back up the middle, I'm a load to stop. We hold the clock down for the town where I'm from. Niggas getting bound in the ground, cause the game over.
I'm gonna give you a good hint.
Hold on. Wait, stop it. Stop it real quick. Do I get to make do I get to use my a line? Do I get a phone call?
We've never done a landline for a championship round. You can make a phone call, and if it's to someone that you think will know this, then we will accept it, and I'll play the song if they can hear it over your speaker.
All right. Damn. I think this person changed their number. All right, I might have one more. Hold on.
And I can also I can throw you a hint on this.
I don't know it at all. Like, I don't know it. Okay, do I get a hint and a call?
You can get a hint and a call. You want to try to call first?
Yeah, let's try to call first.
Okay.
Don't call Kenny Hatch. He ain't gonna know.
You might. I mean, you should be calling someone from Fully Loaded.
Don't call real a person who really knows Filmo history.
Okay.
Hey, Gunner, bruh. The money is on the line right now, man. I need your Filmo expertise, bro. Your extensive. Hey, I got Gunna Goes Global on the phone.
Gunna, what up, Gunna? Mike and Don from the Bridge Podcast.
This is for the belt. I'm on a podcast right now. They played a song. What's all Bullies and Fullies?
This is Fully Loaded off the album Reloaded.
It got Vegan Mob, Big OG Don Toriano, Big Rich, and Bailey, and who else?
And featuring the Riddler.
Okay, and it's they said it was a football themed song.
And
they
we said, need to
if I get the name right, I win the whole competition.
Oh man,
you need
to play the song?
Play the song so you can get it. All right, play the song real quick.
You can't hear.
Damn, I was trying to call Don Toriano, but I think he changed his number. Okay. All right. Hold on. Wait.
Don has to know.
All right. Can we extend this call? Can we put him on through? We got to be able to put him on three way. Hold on. Come on, man. He said he's going to hop on three way.
That'd be so sick.
Hold on.
He actually has the sickest verse on this, Don Toriano, too.
That'd be so sick if he picked up.
Nah, see, this was going to be my original call. So, feel me?
This is a flex, too, to have Don Toriano on speed dial.
Don, what's up with the Don? Hey, man, I'm in a very tight pickle right now. All right, so I'm on this game show right now, and they played up a song, Fully Loaded, you feel me? And I believe you're on the first verse. They said if I get this song right, I win, you feel me? All right, they said I get a lifeline. I used Gunna, but I did my Filmo wiggle to finesse and get you on the phone. So I was like, all right. So I get you really my second call. It's a song that y'all made. If I name it right, then I win. So would you do me the honors and tell me what song this is? Hold on, hit play it one time for him.
Second down.
Hey, hold on, you gotta play his verse. You gotta run it back. Run it back.
Run it back, dude. What?
Can you hear it, Don?
He's got, what's the name of the song?
Oh, play. He couldn't really hear it. You could play it from the first verse again. Okay, you can hear it?
That's for Fully Loaded, Reloaded, and it's called
Come on, it's on the line.
And that's called
How long I got?
About 15
got,
seconds.
For him, since he's on the song, 10 seconds. 15 10. Seconds.
You got 10 seconds. Come on.
I'll give you a hint. It's the name of something that Bill Russell invented. Bill Walsh invented this style.
West Coast offense.
Yep,
West Coast.
That's what it is, dude.
Come on, man. I should have took that hit.
Slapper, dude. Slapper.
Hey, man, you made a banger. I'm on an interview show right now, bro. You just helped me win.
I was going crazy them days, man. You
gotta hear too low. This is a shameless plug, but the real reason why I called Gunna Goes Global and Don Toriano, because they actually have a song on my next album, Healthy Gas, called Non-GMO. You know what I'm saying?
We gonna slap it, bro.
Will Don help you get the belt? And that was a slapper of slappers, West Coast.
Well, thank you, Don. Thank you.
Come on, man.
Bridge
to Bridge champ.
We still winning. We're going to Vegan Mile to celebrate. Come on, man.
For sure.
Hey, man, love you, man. Thank you so much.
I love you, Mo. Let's get it.
All right, I'm going to tap in with you, guy. Keep winning. Hey, do me a favor. Hey, keep being your best self.
I got you, baby.
Come on, man. We still winning. All right, hang up in my face.
Dude, you're the champ, dude. That's it, dude. Sick ass episode.
You got it, dude.
Man, we had to come get the belt. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to United Players, because that's what we are.
You want to shout anyone out or shout, before we end the damn thing?
Shout out my team. Shout out my family, my friends. Shout out everybody that supported me. Shout out God. And I'm thankful for all of those people as well. I'm thankful for the people that Ben had my back. Thankful for people that got my back right now. Thankful for the people who are going to have my back in the future. And I'm thankful for y'all for having me on the podcast.